Hey Mark, how are you?
Right on time, man. On spot. Like timing perfect.
Yeah.
Like at 5 o'clock, I'm like, Mark Jiggins, there he is.
We've got a lot to talk about. Mainly, how are you?
I'm good. You know, I'm fine. I'm hanging in there. You know, just dealing with the constant, you know, day to day routine of doing nothing, staying home, and you know, like all of us, kind of just getting by here. But obviously there's not much to complain about. I'm working, I got my music out, and everything's pretty cool.
A lot's happened. I mean, it's quite surreal, really. Everyone I talk to in the States is having a really tough time. I guess a bit less so on the East Coast than on the West Coast. Everyone's tearing their hair out on the West Coast. But on the West Coast here of Australia, we just had a like fully attended festival on the weekend that we put on.
Really?
Yeah, in a club with 500 people. We've sort of like, it's not like the real world over here. COVID is not here, basically. And so our lives are back to normal, apart from the fact that no one's coming to see us. So our borders are closed. No one can get in, unless you're a tennis player and you're playing at the Australian Open. But
tennis player.
Yeah, because like international events like that still go ahead. But yeah, somehow like they can't allow international artists and stuff like that to come over. So it's a sorry state of affairs. But what it means is we've got a lot more time to listen to music. And we've got a lot more time to check out our local bands. So the byproduct is, over here at least, is people are going out to see bands that would probably pull 50 people, and there's 200 people turning up. So
so it's like kind of pulsing there.
Yeah, it's a weird state of affairs. I've never seen anything like it for years. But I've now listened to your album about half a dozen times. And all I can say is that you're right. I actually think it's the best thing you've done.
Oh, thanks. And you followed me from day one with my solo stuff, pretty much. So.
Yeah, I mean, 2010 was the first time I came over and met you while you were at Tom's studio.
What were we doing? Oh, we were doing 2010. You were around when Thumb Rail Tide was going down.
Exactly.
Gee. Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't realize it was that far back.
So
wow,
it's, cool. That was the first time. The last time was when you were just recording, I think, Days of a Dreamer. Not Days of a Dreamer. The previous album.
Road to Guys? Road to, or was this Mark Knight, titled Mark Knight? Yeah,
no,
that's when you came out. We did the little interview.
Yeah, that's right. I don't know. As someone who's listened to it all, this is the album where I think you've actually really found your voice. Like, this is the album where I can listen to it and think, hey, that's Mark Knight, rather than, hey, I can hear a bit of this or I can hear a bit of that in there. Like, I was always looking at your albums before and thinking, hey, I can hear that. But now I just hear, it's a wonderful mix of styles as well. I mean, there's some heavier stuff on there.
Thanks.
I mean, I love Rusty Bones.
You know me, I'm all over the place, always.
Yeah.
You've done so many amazing reviews on my records, and you know, I was talking about the journey I take on these songs and stuff, but once again, I kind of just, it's a collected group of songs and they're not all sounding the same. You know, I've never really wrote one song and be like, I need another 10 of those, you know?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So there's 13 tracks on the album. Where does it all start? How many demos do you do?
So I demoed 15, I think, or 16 songs. One of them didn't even make it to the recording stage, but one of them did. Which was 14, and we shelved that one. So basically that's kind of what it went down. I just recorded all these songs. I was on this crazy manic recording mode where I was just in the studio for 12 hours at my house. My wife thought I was going crazy. I'm like, no, I got all these songs. I got Pro Tools. I got this computer. I had just got all this stuff. So that's kind of how it all started.
That's cool. Can you remember the first one you wrote for the album?
The first song I wrote for the record, the first one I recorded was Wise Choice. That was the first song I recorded. The actual demo, I brought Edward over, my drummer, who basically, you know, saw this through with me, and I got all these songs. I go, can you come over and help me just, like, you know, record them and get them recorded right so I can sing them and not have to work the computer? And he came over, and that was the first one we started with.
It's interesting you say Wise Choice, because Wise Choice is the one song in there that I think it really has that echo of previous albums on there. I love the sort of like the Tom Petty like vibe, but it's almost like the perfect laid back American pop song. It's
Thanks. Yeah, thanks.
so many people I've played it to or sent a link to the video have absolutely loved it, and this is people who have probably never heard of you before.
Very
It's
cool. I just got some like fan from Australia that just contacted me today,
cool.
and I got talking to Mark Diggins at Rock Pit in about half hour. So that it's getting out there a little bit. Yeah, very
Cool.
cool.
Yeah, because we had a problem with our media the other day. Facebook sort of shut all Australian news media links down
I saw that. I saw
because
your post.
yeah, so it's getting pretty frustrating. But
Yeah, what the hell?
ours came up pretty early because I was arguing it's an interview and review site, it's not a news site, and that's what we classified it as. But it's the government versus Facebook over here and the big tech companies. I played the album from start to finish in running order. Running order is
Okay.
perfect for me. I think you've got it just right. Rusty Bones is a fantastic way to start because it opens up with that sounding like maybe the heaviest song that the Unsung Heroes have done. But I just
Yeah.
love the reggae that you get in there. It's fantastic.
That weird?
Yeah.
That was a weird kind of switch up there, you know?
But it works perfectly. It just sort of like turns the song on its head, and it's just instantly fantastic. Wise Choice, of course, most people have probably heard out there as well. I'm going to try and get the review up on the same day I put the interview up as well.
That one, you know, I kind of started with that one because it basically had like a kind of a collective vibe of the whole record. You know, it had a
Yeah.
good hook, it had a good driving chorus, it had the acoustic element of it, it had the kind of vocal that I was kind of saying something that meant something to me. It just felt like the right song to release. I mean, I probably could have started out with the rocker, but you know, I just thought that was just a. It just always moved me listening on the playbacks. I'm like, I'm gonna put this one out first. So yeah.
Yeah, I mean, it's fantastic. I love the title track as well. The title track, when I first heard it, I thought, wow, there's a lot in there. There's a lot of sounds that I'm loving. There's Americana, there's pop, there's rock. But I even was like getting a little bit of really early U2 in there as well. And your
I heard
voice.
that. I've been hearing U2 on this. That's
Yeah.
so funny. That's so weird. That's like you're like the third person that said U2. I don't know. That song is kind of. I was kind of going with kind of. I don't know. I've been kind of influenced by some of the indie rock. My daughters and you know are into like all this obscure indie rock, and I've been listening to some of it. And that song kind of came out of that influence, even though it's still sounds like rock, you know.
Yeah.
But they kind of you know, I just got on this kick with that song 1,000 times with a certain style, and I just came up with these songs. Almost, I thought they almost sounded like, you know, kind of like Smashing Pumpkins a little bit or something
Yeah.
like in that vein. Yeah, that's cool.
And I
You too,
love.
yeah, I got that a couple
Yeah,
times.
but the really early stuff like Boy or October or something like that before they were big,
When they add more of a raw sound, not
yeah,
so overproduced, kind of, yeah.
exactly. And I love the sort of like nicely restrained solo on that one as well, and how that bleeds into the record. It's wonderful. And the lyric about
Thanks.
squirrels and their nuts as well.
You like that one?
It's great, yeah.
It's like really, like what the hell? Like what is he singing about? Squirrels and their nuts?
Yeah.
Honestly, in my backyard, I have like 1,000 squirrels, right? When I was writing that, it was like winter, and the squirrels, they collect these nuts off these trees and they bury them till, you know, till winter comes, hold out till the end. So yeah, and I just like threw it in a line. It's like days of a dreamer sitting back there writing songs. Yeah.
It works for me. It's one of those ones. I mean, your lyrics like throw up so many images, and that's one of the things I like about the words. But sometimes you just get
Oh, thanks.
that really unexpected image, and it just sticks with you all the way through.
I just thought it was was like a weird wordplay thing. I'm like, yeah, it's kind of cool.
I'm going to go through the whole album because I've never ever done that before
Sure. Yeah, I bet. Yeah,
with
absolutely.
anyone.
Good time.
So I thought I'd do it, and I'm going to devote a whole podcast to you. So we're going to put this out on a podcast and hopefully play some extracts of some of the songs if that's cool. I love the lyrics to A Thousand Times, but you've got to tell us the story behind that one.
Oh man, it's that one is just like, yeah, I'm basically describing somebody. It's a lot of different people, but it's like some, you know, kind of personal people in my life that kind of maybe spur up some of those lyrics and end up right where you belong, even though I'm not gonna like pray for you, kind of. So kind of a dark song, actually.
Yeah, I think everyone has people like that around them that it's just so frustrating that, I mean, I completely get the words to that song. I think everyone will really relate to it.
Yeah, right on. Yeah, you know, it's like, you know, I'm not gonna like say exactly who it is, but it's like, you know, it's a couple people in my life that basically weren't the greatest of people or humans, and you know, you ended up right where you belong is basically like the closer, and coming up from the cracks like weeds, you know. Yeah, it's like there's a lot of wordplay on that one.
Yeah. And Fools Like You is interesting. It's another rocking one that sort of like falls into an almost, it's almost like spoken word type verse followed by that fantastic chorus, which I absolutely love. I got the feeling that that was like a lyrical rebuttal to someone we might know.
Kinda, yeah, you might be right. Amongst other people.
Yeah,
basically just like a lot of people spewing a bunch of shit out on social media and just not, you know, without any really backing or just nonsense. And I just don't have time for it. It's another one about more than one person, but kind of a generalization of, you know, some people in my life, you know.
I know, people.
You know, not trying to like be vague or anything, but you know, it's just basically like, you know, people talking shit. And,
that's exactly.
You know, seeing a bunch of stuff, and you know, I just don't have time for it. I'm not gonna, you know, give you the fight or indulge in your negativity.
And I think you're exactly right in what you say. By not naming names, we're taking the higher ground, and that's the way to go.
Yeah.
Aside from that sort of like fantastic opening, because I didn't find myself skipping anything on the way through, one of my favourite songs on the album at the moment, and it has changed over the time, is Open Wounds. Almost like the ballad of the album. I love the female backing vocals.
That's Scarlett, my daughter.
Yeah, and that's a beautiful solo on there as well. It just feels so fresh and organic. Like,
thank you. Like so that's an old lost jam, Mark. So back in 1995, I think I wrote that living on the beach in Malibu.
Oh wow!
And I demoed this record called Sound Scraps, like on a 4-track.
Yeah.
It was a cassette with 10 songs on it, and I lost it. And Tig Kettler from Bang Tango, my drummer, you know, he goes, Mark, I found this cassette of yours. I go, what is it? He goes, it's Sound Scraps. I'm like, dude, I've been looking for that forever. Send that to me. I go, I'm dying to hear those songs. And I listen 9 down, and Samantha, my wife, goes, that song is like, that's like one of your best songs you've ever written. You need to redo that. So I did a whole rewrite on it, and there we go. That's we made the record.
Yeah, they were all right. I mean, I love it. It's definitely one of my favorites on there. How are the guys? Because of course you've got Carl Stevens playing in the band, but you had a few other guests from Bang Tango on there as well. Did Tig play?
Well, Tig actually he came in and did a song the one song I told you about, the 14th song, that didn't make the record. Not because of him, just because lyrically I was saying some stuff that I just, in this time in my life, I really didn't want to put out. Yeah. So I shelved that song. It was called Storybooks. That was the name of the song. And Tig came out and played great, and we mixed it, but I was just like, I can't put this out. So unfortunately, Tig didn't make it. Kyle played on a couple songs. He played on Days of a Dreamer and Days of a Dreamer and Wise Choice.
Yeah.
And Kyle Stevens played on 3 songs too. He played on Rusty Bones, played on Fools Like You, and then he also played on the solo on Lost on the Road.
Cool. I mean, it's fantastic. It all comes together well, and there's so much going on. A lot of the songs, the more you listen to them, that I think you just take more and more every time. But what I love most on this one is the fact that there is such a variety of styles. So you've got stuff like Open Wounds up against a song like Judge Me, which is just
a totally different trip, right?
Just a fun song, yeah.
It's like the Stones, man, when they like put like ballads on and they throw like a rocker on, you know. It's just like,
yeah. Well, I've been going on a Stones revisiting trip at the minute. I was just listening to Beggar's Banquet before one of my favorites. Yeah.
So great, right?
It's a fantastic one. So Judge Me must have been fun to write.
Judge Me, yeah. That was, you know, open G tuning, real Stones influence kind of deal. Real life story about some of the crap I was doing, you know, coming up with people judging me and some of the stuff I was going through, like, you know, post my divorce and stuff, and just kind of real life stories about, you know, going to the bar, coming home before the cops get me. And this, it was kind of, you know, I was kind of out there for a minute, but so I reflected that and just wrote it into the song.
Yeah. Another Man's Woman is an interesting one as well, sort of like a tale of woe, and I got a bit of ZZ Top in there, like really well hidden.
I just did a podcast earlier today, and the guy goes, "It's like Tom Petty's lost track." I go, "Tom Petty, I think it sounds like ZZ Top to me." He just called it. Yeah. I'm like, "Tom Petty?" He goes, "No, like his earlier stuff." I'm like, "I think it sounds like ZZ Top."
we're right. We'll take that one.
We'll take that one.
Aside from Open Wounds, my other favorite at the moment is the next one, Dark Roots. Musically, I think that's my favorite on there. It opens up so beautifully, and then it gets all sort of like reflective and laid back as well. What can you tell me about that song? It's absolutely beautiful.
So Dark Roots was, you know, it's kind of like a reflection of some of my life at the time, like my daughter's growing up and moving out, and, you know, me reflecting my own personal life and different things and stuff about, like, I was thinking about, like, you know, sleep in peace, my girl. I was talking about my wife, basically, like, you know, let the past leave us alone, kind of. And, you know, a real acoustic song, you know, it basically was just real raw acoustic, and thought it was one of my better songs in the demo, and, you know, we electrified it and brought in a bunch of, it's kind of really produced, that one now, the way it finally came out. But I'm getting some good response on that one, actually, from some of the fans. So that's kind of the story behind it.
Yeah, it's definitely one of my favorites. I love checking out the next one. And when I said I was talking to you, I know two other people who'd listened to this in Australia, and I said, "Let me know if you've got any questions for Mark, because I'm going to be talking to him like today." And they said, "What are you checking out of?"
That's like my favorite song on the record.
Yeah.
Like, straight up. Like, basically, in the song, I'm checking out of the relationship between, like, the people I'm talking about and how they've done me wrong. Like, I'm done with you, basically. So that's the answer to that question. You know, checking out, like, you know, call me a brother. I dare to disagree, you know. If you listen to the lyrics, it's basically, you know, I had some fallouts with some people at the time, and that's like, I'm checking out for good this time. I'm done with you, basically.
Is it what we fear it might be about? Another band situation?
No, it's not about any band. No, it's not about band. It's about a personal relationship with an old friend. It's not about checking out from a band. It's just about checking out of a friendship that went bad, basically, because I was screwed over.
Yeah.
By a certain person, you know? I mean, that's pretty much black and white.
Yeah, I think we can all relate to that one as well. Just as I was getting towards the end of the album, I was thinking, is there going to be a real bluesy number? And Lost on the Road, you give it to us. Actually, really suits your voice. I thought that bluesy style sort of, I wasn't sure if it was going to sort of
back to that, and also it was a real moody song, and that almost didn't make the record, because I actually wrote that for the Don't Kill the Cat record.
Okay.
And I wanted to go in and record it before we finished, but we didn't have enough time.
Yeah.
So I kept working on it over the years, and It came out surprisingly really good.
Yeah, almost like a sort of Chris Isaacy, swampy, bluesy vibe.
Yeah, exactly. Like moody and dark, and you know, a chirpy song. That's basically about, like, lyrically, it's about, you know, kind of a dream that I had, a reoccurring dream about being lost on the road. I think it's from all the touring I did over the years and not being able to tour anymore. Mm-hmm. So I have this, like, kind of reoccurring dream about basically being lost on the road, like the story goes, you know. So I wrote a song about it.
Cool. And there's a nice country twang to Mid-July, which was the one, I think, it's another one of those that's a grower. I mean, first time I heard it, I thought, yeah, that's okay, I don't mind that one. But the more I hear it, the more I like it. It's
I didn't like the way that one came out, really, like production wise. It should have been a little bit more twangy or a little bit more kind of stripped down and more countrified, but instead of so driving like it is. But I mean, it's a good song, you know. It made the record because basically, like, it's got like enough goodness in it to put on a record. But I would have just approached it differently, mix wise and production wise. But you know, when you're doing so many songs and you're working with your friends and people that are helping you out, you can't, like, really, sometimes you let things get away where maybe we should approach it this way. But yeah, I'm glad you like it.
Yeah, and the party's over. You left us with something a little bit different. I must admit, I was surprised when the female vocal kicked in right at the start.
Yeah, so that's my friend Angie from Angie and the Deserve. She's an old friend of ours. And I've originally just said, hey, you want to come sing on some backgrounds on the song? And, you know, she was singing some backgrounds and wasn't really making or breaking the song. So then me and Edward, we decided, hey, why don't you just sing the song? And, you know, maybe we'll make this into like a duet. And that's kind of how that evolved. And we couldn't really use her first take. So then she came back to the studio again and did another one. We put together this cool kind of duet with me and her and kind of told the story in two different perspectives.
Yeah, it works really well. I'm a big fan. So the whole sort of country Americana type vibe. Beautiful way to close.
Yeah, kind of like starts with the rocking and then it ends with the back to the grassroots, huh?
Yeah. So normally after an album like that, and I said I'll have the review up soon, I'd ask about where you're taking it out on the road. But obviously COVID's done for us as far as that's concerned. So I've loved watching you in the Pirates Cove. That's been pretty cool. So
that must be on at, like, what time is that on at your time? Like 6 a.m. or something?
Yeah. So it's good because before I go to work, I can flick that on and have a look. So that's been cool. And you're going to be doing a Facebook streaming special for the playing some songs off the new record as well. Remind us when.
Yeah, this Saturday I'm gonna do a Pirates Cove Days of a Dreamer session.
Yeah, so I'm gonna, if I don't get the interview up by then, I'll stick a little news piece on the site saying
it's
gonna
be great.
Saying it's gonna be on there.
Killer.
Yeah,
I'm gonna do like probably 8 songs and Mark Jamalia, you know Mark. He's gonna play guitar with me on that one because he's been doing a couple of the Pirates Cove sessions with me acoustic and so he's gonna come out and play for that, so that'll be cool.
Yeah, no, that'd be great. I saw his morning solos that he's been doing, or whatever that series is he's got on there. That's pretty cool.
The Sunday morning sounds great, right?
Yeah, it's fantastic. I think it's your best yet. It just needs to be heard by people, so let's get it heard by people. One of the things we've been asking everyone we've been talking to at this stage is about, and I'm just going to give you a bit of time to think about this, and then we'll come back to it, because I've got a few questions from some of our readers. We've got a radio station now, and a podcast, and the web page, and we're doing some touring and stuff. So, 5 albums for isolation. So a lot of people are listening to or re-listening to stuff while they're locked down, and as you say, sat there doing nothing in a lot of cases. So what do? You hopefully grab some vinyl or a CD or maybe even if you're young enough, you do a bit of streaming and listen to some stuff to inspire you, or just something you want to revisit and listen to again. So I'm going to ask you for 5 albums in a minute. But taking it back all the way to the start of last year, Bang Tango with the original guys played a wonderful show at the Whiskey. Everything was lined up, obviously, for festival dates and potentially some other dates, and then all that got knocked on the head. Has it just been postponed till later this year? What's the latest?
At the moment, I talked to our booking agents the other day, and he basically said we're looking at some dates in midsummer, but they're not confirmed because they're planning to do some stuff, but no, there's no confirmation on anything right now. It's all just talk right now, but we're just hoping and the vaccination is going to make it better, and I guess this thing's going to like cool out. But there's really no I'm actually going to play a winery in March, on March 20th.
Oh, wow.
Acoustic solo, outdoors, social distancing, but that'll be my second show since this COVID thing's really kicked in.
That's crazy.
And kind of nervous about that, but it's as far as the band playing or Bang Tango playing, or my solo band or anything, just there's nothing really getting booked or anything at the moment. I mean, I think everybody's still going to need to give it another year.
Yeah.
Until it really, really kicks off. I mean, some of my friends are out gigging, they're doing these social distance shows and, they're booking bands in Texas right now. And it just doesn't seem right still.
Yeah. It's crazy out there, and it's different wherever you are. I mean, the UK, all my friends in the UK have not played for, it's getting on to almost a year now.
Are they gigging in the UK at all?
No, not at all, no. For a while they did. They did some weird, so they had some really good ideas. They did Ricky Warwick, who's, I think he just lives down the road from you, actually, from the Almighty and Black Star Riders and all that sort of thing.
Black Star Riders, sure. I know the bass player.
Back in Ireland a while ago, he played car park concerts. So it was all socially distanced, but they wouldn't let them play in the club, so they had to play in the car park.
Jeez.
People have been doing driving.
I don't know. I just haven't even it's really bummed everybody out, but what are you going to do? We can't go out there and put people in danger and,
no,
you
know. Exactly. Yeah.
You know, and some of these bands were rock and roll, we're going to go out and play, but it's then all of a sudden there's a spread again and everything kicks up again, and it's
it's so hard, isn't it? Because everyone's got to be in it together. That's the only way we're ever going to get through it.
If they keep avoiding what's gonna put an end to this, or at least slow it down enough where we can kind of get back to normal, people are gonna rebel, not wear masks and not do this, not do that, and go out and think that they're gonna live their life, and because they'll sacrifice COVID for a rock night out. It's just never gonna end. I mean, people are gonna continue to get this, and I don't know.
It's almost impossible. I mean, we were lucky, I guess, in a way that we sort of clamped down hard early, and even though everyone complained for a couple of months, we got rid of it. So it was.
Australia's looking pretty good with it, right?
Yeah, yeah. I mean, in the West, we had one case in the last 9 months, and that was
had 500,000 cases.
Yeah. So you should come over here for 6 months and just do a bit of surfing.
I think a lot of bands are going over there. I've seen some bands booking tours over there, I think.
Now, one thing I didn't know about you, I knew you had cats, but I didn't realize you had a turtle.
A turtle? Is that what you said? A turtle?
Yeah, a turtle. What's his name?
Frankie the turtle that we found out was a girl.
Oh, Frankie can be a girl.
So the story with the turtle is my daughter Scarlett, when she was 12 or 13, went to some carnival and won this turtle, and it was in her bedroom underneath blankets and stuff in this tiny little container. It was the size of a nickel.
Yeah.
And Samantha, my wife's Scarlett, that's a living life. What are you doing? That's an animal. Took this turtle in and basically went out and bought this killer aquarium, and spent $200 on this big thing, and the little turtle grew into this giant red, what they call the red snapper,
yeah.
And now the thing's my responsibility, so it's my turtle now.
Nice.
We found out it was was a girl because it like hatched eggs one day. We're like, what the hell's in the tank? It's like white round balls. Oh, wow. Turns out they're like the turtle's a girl, not a boy. And one time she got out of the tank, jumped down, and ended up in like the capital, because it's water. Yeah. And I'm like, the turtle is in the capital. How did that happen?
I can feel a song.
They're bizarre animals, but they live forever.
Yeah, they do. I can feel a song coming on the next album about the turtle. We have the squirrels on this one. So let's go now. Let's close out with the five albums for Isolation. What are your five albums that you think people should be listening to during lockdown? Five that mean something to you.
I don't know. What am I listening to? Like, what am I listening to? What do I think people should listen to? I mean, there's so much. You know what I've been listening to is, like, early Iron Maiden lately.
Oh, wow.
For some weird reason. Like, some of those early records, like Killers and stuff. Yeah. I mean, I have, like, serious metal roots. But, you know, then I listen to, you know, a lot of Americana music, like Jason Isbell's latest. Yeah. And, you know, I like Ryan Adams. I like his new one. Even though he's kind of got himself into some trouble out here. I don't know if you know about it, but still his music's great. I like, what else? I'm trying to think of some new stuff. You know, all the classic rock I still kind of listen to here and there. But I don't know. I mean, when Eddie Van Halen died, I like revisited the Van Halen records. So I was such an Eddie Van Halen freak as a kid. Just didn't realize how great he actually was when I listened to some of those earlier Van Halen records. So I went through that kick when he died, you know.
No, it's good, some cool stuff there. I mean, I love the fact it's so varied. I mean, I can listen to some blues one day and then a bit of Americana the next and then some hair metal the day after. So it's always great to talk to you, and especially when you got an album out. But I just thought this year was going to be the year we were going to go to Vegas together and watch the Raiders.
I know, right? Jeez.
Yeah. So
we got to do that. Okay, we have to make a pact. We're gonna do that, right?
We definitely are. Let's hope they're still in Vegas. Because I try and watch as many games as I can, but it's always difficult.
If all goes well and all this pandemic is gone, we can go to Vegas. I have family there, so we can like totally hang out there, and then we'll go to the game. We got to go see him play there.
It's a deal. Well, we'll do it. We'll do that. So then next year. And hopefully we'll get to check out Mark Knight and the Unsung Heroes playing live. So Days of a Dream has been out a few days now. All the feedback I'm seeing is fantastic. You can find it on Spotify. You can buy it from your web store, which I'd encourage everyone to do. Still got a few posters left. They were almost gone last time I checked.
Yep, still got those. Yeah, I got some Bang Tango picks for you, those that collect Bang Tango stuff and signed autograph picks. So.
Cool. So everyone should go to Mark Knight and the UnsungHeroes.com, which you'll post a link at the end of the interview. And we'll catch up real soon.
Awesome, Mark. Thanks for having me as always. Great talking to you and catching up. I need to put an album out so we can talk more often.
No, I'm sure we'll catch up again by the end of the year. But we'll
absolutely. And feel free to review it. That'd be great because nobody's really done like a formal super. Yeah. It's only been out a week today.
Haven't seen one yet. Mine's almost done. So I'll put the finishing touches today. And the podcast is out in March, so we'll be hearing you on the podcast as well. You take care of yourself.
Great to talk to you. Let's go Raiders.
Yeah, go Raiders. Raider Nation. Okay, mate. Take care.
All right, Mark. Have a good night. Yeah. Or good day. Well, I don't know what time it is.
I'm just about to start work now, so it's getting on for 10 a.m.
Okay.
No worries, mate. Take care.
All right, my man. Good talking to you.
Thanks, Mark. Cheers.